you this morning. Amen. Such a weather outside. Raining. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. We also want to welcome those who is watching this broadcast. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. And we pray that this service will be a blessing to each of us. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Well, let's we open up in prayer in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We thank you, Father, for who you are. We thank you, Father, for everything that you have done, continue to do in each of our lives. We ask you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that you speak to us. We ask you, Lord God, as Pastor Larry come and minister into your people, we pray, Father, that you use him as your instrument, as your vessel, Lord God, to speak the words of truth, Lord God. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, as we are your people, we know the truth. And let the truth, your truth, will set us free. That your people walk in a freedom in every area in their life. They will not be deceived, they will not be defeated. Freedom through Christ Jesus in every area in their lives. And Father, we thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit in this place. And also those who is watching this broadcast, we believe that is no distance in the Spirit. The same anointing, the same presence of God that is here this morning will touch the people, those who is watching this broadcast. And Father, we're giving you a praise and we're giving you a glory. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. God is so good. He is a faithful God. He is a good God. He wants to strengthen you. He wants to restore you. He wants to guide you in a path that you should go, because he has a plan. He has a purpose for each of our lives. When we're born again of the Spirit of God, accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, is also the impartation of the destiny and the purpose God impart in each of our lives. Hallelujah. So now we need to walk in this destiny and a purpose. Not in a way that we want to walk, not in a way someone else wants us to walk, but in a way according to his will, God's will, according to his purpose. Amen. Because where we and the will of God, that is a safety. Where you are in anointing or in your calling, what God placed in your life, there is the safety, because that's you and your gift. This is your anointing for that purpose. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I believe in this year, God gonna bring the restoration in many of your lives, your family, and maybe a personal restoration. And also, we're gonna believe that he will show you and you will hear what is it you have to do as the body of Christ, as the part of the body of Christ. In our earliest church, you remember from the scripture, what we see in the scripture, early church was growing, tremendously is growing. I mean, multiplied how it's growing. Well, it was not so much social media there, not so much advertisement there, but the power of God and anointing of God, the presence of Jesus was drawing men through the anointing. So also we see from the example of the early church was very important part of the spiritual gifts in the body of Christ. So when people come together in unity, a lot of times for the, like, they went to the house to house, they have a church meetings, like a house meetings. They share food together, they pray together, and also been a manifestation of the spiritual gifts. Hallelujah. So we as the body of Christ is an important part, each of us, no matter what's the position we have in a body. Someone is maybe a preacher, someone is the deacon, someone is the, you know, it's so many, like maybe you've been called to the children's ministry, ministry of health. It's so many different things that we can do in the body of Christ. But when we come together as the church, that's when the spiritual gifts can exercise. You know, the scripture says, iron, sharp iron. Well, in the beginning, when God was established this ministry years ago, we started from the home church. So we was meeting many times a week, and we have so many people come, and we was pray, we was share meals together. We did a lot of praying. We did a lot of sharing. It's like it was feel like really like early church, because we saw the manifestations of the Spirit of God. We have children, we have like from the 1 or 2 year old up to the one. We have one lady, she was 87 something, but it was no difference in the spirit, like of the age. We all, as the body of Christ, it was not any children ministry, go to another room with the kids. No, it was everybody in the same room, and everybody was worship the Lord. Everybody was just intercede. Everybody was seeking the Lord and hear from heaven. This was an awesome, awesome time that we was experience in these times. So that's what early church, I believe, was experienced, because people came. One time we have a service at home, and God was leading that particular service. People have some problems with the teeth. Some, you know, we share. One sister said, "Well, I have a problem here and with my tooth." Another problem, some tooth issue. And then we started to call up in the name of the Lord, understanding with the anointing what God wants to do this, you know, this day, and the manifestation of healing in that particular area people was receive. So God will meet the needs of the people because He loves us. So when we come together as a body of Christ, it's amazing what Jesus, for the work of the Holy Spirit, can do. And that meetings, when we come together, that's powerful. So what the enemy wants to do in these days, because of his demonic tricks, he bring the division in the body of Christ. He bring dissociation from each other. And some of us remember when the COVID was in the earth, or some of that situation was with the COVID, you know, they tried to lock the churches, they want to separate the people. Why? Because it is the power in the body of Christ, it is a power in unity. It's something special when we as the body of Christ come together. The word of God says, iron sharp iron. So when we come together and we pray together and we seek in the Lord together, the manifestation of His Spirit, of His anointing, will be poured out in that place. And God, He's disturbing, like a releasing, how to say this in English, He releasing the spiritual gifts. See, it's not just one a man gathering. I remember I went to visit one of the ministries I don't want to say the name. It's in a like a Bay Area somewhere, and it's a huge building. It's like a big, and hundreds of people come. And it's like a theatrical setting, or like, I don't know, some kind of like you up, seeing up. And people come from different direction. They have a nice music. They have nice, everything nice. But I'm recognized people just kind of like, kind of slip in and slipped out. It's not like a family, you know what I'm saying? It's like, and I don't know the structure of that particular ministry. They might have some home groups. That will be wonderful, because hold this amount of people, you have to have some kind of, you know, structure that people can come together. But the fact is, a lot of times, like I notice, because I like to observe, I'm an observer. So, and I've noticed that some people come and sit somewhere in the back, and the usher come and want to say hi, and they kind of like, oh, don't bother me. But this is not what the church is about. Church is about as a family in Christ, right? We are family. We holding each other in prayer. We are encourage one another as the body of Christ. And this way is the manifestation of the spiritual gifts, so the prophetic gifts and healing gifts will manifest. We have so many times God is manifest a healing anointing in our services. I personally got so many times healed. Don't even have to go in the front. Just right there while I was, God was brought healing. Hallelujah. So that's what was a early church was, and this is what the church is. That's what is Jesus wants to manifest himself on behalf of his people. It's not just to listen a nice message, but to receive his word, encourage one another, manifestation of the Spirit of God, and the spiritual gifts. And I believe Pastor Larry might gonna teach this year in the spiritual gifts. I think he was teaching last year, right, Larry?
Spiritual warfare.
Warfare. And then also the spiritual gifts, because it's not just a one man, it's also as the body of Christ. Every gift is important in the body of Christ. Teachers is important, right? Because they chew in the word. They give us understanding of the word of God. Prophetic gifts are important, right? Evangelistic gifts is important. Every spiritual gift is important. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, before Pastor Larry come, I'm going to pray for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Nice to see you. Praise the Lord. Well, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you, Father, for your people, those, everyone who is here this morning, and those who is watching this broadcast. Father, I speak blessings over your people. I speak the sound mind over your people. Those maybe who going from some spirit of heaviness and discouragement, I break every demon spirit of suppression, of depression, of any spirit that is not of God. I bind, I loose it in the name of Jesus. And I command you, devil, flee from God's people. I thank you, Lord God, that your people will continue to walk by faith. They will not look at the circumstances. They will not look what they are facing in their lives, because they know that they have a victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, I ask you, Lord God, let your angelic manifestation will manifest in your people's lives. Even the dreams and visions at night, or visions during the day, Father, they will see. Let their eyes of understanding will be enlightened. Let them walk in the truth. Hallelujah of your word. And Father, let your name be glorified for your people's lives. In the name of Jesus, there will be a testimony for your kingdom. And the people, even the enemies, they will look up at them and they will say, wow, look what the Lord has done. And that your name will be glorified. And Father, we're giving you a praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. Well, we have Pastor Larry here.
Glory.
So he going to
Hallelujah.
Ministering to us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Me?
Okay. If y'all say so.
Okay.
How y'all doing? When I saw y'all coming in, I said, oh my God, we're going to have church today. Amen. How you, everybody all right, though? That's wonderful. That's wonderful. We are all here in the presence of the Lord today, and I want to encourage you to open up your hearts. Amen. To prepare to receive. And we have our young friends with us, too, huh? Good. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So now, we started on something on the first of the year. The presence of the Lord and the principles of the kingdom. Amen. But we're going to continue along that line. Because God spoke to my heart Friday night. He said, stay the course. You know, we was here praying, as we do every Friday night when we're in town. And God spoke to my heart very firm, very strong. Amen. And he said, to stay the course. And so I typed that up in Google to find out what that word, exactly what that word means. It means a lot. Amen. It means a lot. Amen. And so I want to encourage you. I know some of you are facing situations. Some of you are having challenges in your life. Amen. Whether you're young or old, it doesn't matter. We all have challenges. Amen. But at the same time, God is telling us to stay focused. He's telling us to stay focused. He's telling us not to look at the circumstances. Rather than looking at the circumstances, he said, look to him. Amen. So we're going to stay the course. People might say something about you. People might not like you. They might try to down you, try to put you down or whatever. They might even start saying things they shouldn't be saying about you. But God said, don't allow the faces of those people to deter you from what he has called you to do. He said, stay the course. Amen. Because see, you stay the course, that means you're not gonna give up just because the battle's getting hit harder and harder. You're not gonna quit just because people are looking at you and saying things about you that it's going against what God told you to do. Amen. So you're going to stay the course not because of what they're saying about you. You're going to stay the course that because what God told you to do. Amen. Because of what God said for you to do. So we're going to stay the course today. Y'all want to stay the course?
Yeah.
Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you, Lord God, that you would show yourself strong in our midst. I ask you, Father, that you would give us the word today that will help us to see ourselves walking in the authority of the kingdom, walking in the power of the kingdom. Father, above all, walking in intimacy with you. In intimacy with you. Because as we walk in the principles of the kingdom, Father, we're going to draw closer to you. Then our intimacy with you is going to become more real than ever before. And your name will be glorified, Father, because we are not looking at what we can accomplish in our own self. We're looking at what we can accomplish by spending time in you. In your presence. God, we thank you. We praise you. We glorify. We thank you, Lord God, that today marks the day of a fresh new beginning for each and every one of us. And we give you all the glory for it in Jesus' name. Now, Father, I ask you that you would anoint every ear to hear. Prepare every heart to receive. Make my tongue as of a pen of a ready writer to write your word upon the hearts and upon the mind of your people that they will know the truth and that the truth shall make them free, and we covenant with you now that we're going to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise in Jesus' mighty, majestic name. Amen and amen. Well, God bless you all. Welcome to New Life of Christ Jesus Church, where Jesus Christ is glorified. And I believe that today we do have a word that's going to minister to your heart. Amen. I believe that God is going to speak to our hearts today. And I believe that that he's going to speak very, very firm. Amen. Very firm. I want to take your attention to the book of Joshua chapter 1. The book of Joshua chapter 1. Amen. This is the scripture that God gave me. This is one of the scriptures that God gave me when he gave me this message. Amen. So we're going to go over. This is like what they call a base scripture. Amen. And so let's look in Joshua chapter 1. And let's read verse number 7 and 8. Verse number 7 and 8. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the what? The law. According to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Then he tells us to turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. See, if we're gonna make any progress in our walk with God, this is why he wants us to stay the course. If we stay the course, I'm telling you, folks, we're on a winning team. We're not gonna lose. Amen. Verse number 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. So how are we going to be able to do what God called us to do? How are we going to stay the course? We're going to have to meditate on the word of God. Amen. Allow the word of God have interest in our heart. Notice what he said, verse number 8 again. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Good success. Look at verse number 9. Have not I commanded thee, be strong? God is speaking to us. Have not I commanded thee, be strong and of good courage? Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is what? Is with thee whithersoever thou goest. See, God is showing us, and when he spoke to my heart on Friday night, God, he spoke it twice. He spoke it firm. Amen. And he said, stay the course. In other words, God is calling us to prepare, because there's a battle coming. There's a spiritual. See, you already in battle. You just don't know it. You already in battlefield. You just don't know that you are. And because you don't know that you are, you're not really concerned about the things that's happening around you. Amen. Because it has become so normal. But whether you know it or not, you're in spiritual battle right now. And God is telling us to stay the course, because the battle is not ours. The battle is the Lord's. Amen. So if the battle is the Lord's, then he is expecting us to draw closer to him. Amen. He is expecting us to begin to apply the principles of the kingdom. Amen. He is expecting us to walk closer with him, that we, just like when Adam and Eve walked with God in the Garden of Eden, they experienced intimacy with God. Amen. See, God wants us to experience intimacy with him. As we begin to draw close to God, we begin to walk in intimacy, we're going to begin to experience deliverance on every side. You may be experiencing some things in your life. You may be experiencing things in your health. You may be experiencing things in your relationship. You may be experiencing things in your finances. You may be experiencing things in your business, in your job, whatever you have. Amen. But if you draw close to God and you begin to walk in that presence, amen, you begin to walk in His presence, that intimate time with God, God is going to draw close to you, and He's going to begin to see your heart. And as He begins to see your heart, those things that has gripped you, those things that have tried to take control of you, those things are going to be broken off of you. That spirit of infirmity, that spirit of debt, that spirit of fear, that spirit of doubt, that spirit of unbelief, all these things that is working against you, that spirit of deception, all these things that is working against you, going to be broken off of you. You're going to be just like that eagle. You're going to begin to soar. A crow, they have to flap their wings when they fly. Amen. But the eagle, he spreads his wing and he just glides. Amen. He glides. And then when he want to go high, then he just flap a little bit. Then he begin to soar high, go round and round, going higher. God is going to take you higher. God's getting ready to take you higher. In His presence. He's getting ready to take you higher in the anointed. He's getting ready to take you higher in the spirit. He's getting ready to take you higher in your intimacy with Him. Woo! Glory to God. Glory. Glory. And I'm ready because I tell you what, as I study this lesson, as I see what God is saying to me, and He telling me to stay the course, you know what that says to me? That tells me that I don't have to be concerned about the things around me as long as I stay focused on Him. Amen. Yeah. Now, God has given us, He's given us instructions now. He said, we got to understand what God is saying to us, because you see, God is calling us to reach out. He's called us to reach out to Him. Because as we reach out to Him, let me tell you something. His presence is going to begin to be so real in your life that when you walk, you're going to see the presence of the Lord touching people around you, and people are going to be drawn to you, and the presence of the Lord that's upon you is going to begin to minister to them. You see, you've been called to be like Christ. Whether you know it or not, you're supposed to be acting like Christ. You're supposed to be implementing Christ. You're supposed to be just like Him. Amen. You're supposed to be just like Him. I'm telling you, when you're walking in this earth, you're supposed to be a light. You too. You're supposed to be a light. Amen. You're in this world. There's darkness all around in each and every one of us. But we don't need to be caught up in the darkness that we see every day. If you draw close to Him, if you draw nigh unto me, He said, I will draw nigh unto you. Amen. When you draw nigh to Him, He draw nigh to you. Guess what? That darkness that you are in, that you are encountering every day, is going to be caught up in the light that you are walking in. Why? Because that light that you're walking in is going to expose the darkness, and the darkness is going to flee. I can cut this light off over here, and darkness will fill this area right here. Mm-hmm. It's not going to fill the whole room, mm-hmm. but it'll fill this area. Yeah. See, when I begin to walk according to the world, my light goes out. Not all the lights around me are going to go out, but the light that I'm supposed to be sharing in the earth is going to be dim. Mm-hmm. Why? Because of my life, because of what I have, because what I stand for, because of what I'm allowing. Y'all understand what I'm saying? But when you begin to allow God to have presence in your heart, in your life, you're going to begin to experience the light of God everywhere you go. And in other words, you're going to walk in His presence. And you're going to find that God not only going to be there in your presence, you're going to find out that God always going to, he's going to be there in your provision. Whatever you, whenever there's a need represented in your life, when you begin to pray, when you begin to talk to God, when you begin to seek God's face concerning what you're experiencing, God's going to begin to guide you around to the place where that need can be met. Y'all ever experienced that?
Yes.
Even in my business, I take on a lot of jobs that I've never done before. Not because I'm so good, but because I like a challenge. They say, "Have you ever done it?" I said, "No, but if man built it, I can do something. I can work with it." Amen. I'm not good. I'm not that good with electronics and stuff like that now. But you get me something. You give me something that man has built, or something that man has made a structure that have. Now I can deal with that. Amen. But now listen to this. Listen to this. God wants you to begin to see yourself walking in the principles of who you are in Him. Let me shine it. Let me see if I kind of give you some information along this line. Because you see, y'all look at me like I don't, like you say, "Wow, what is he talking about?" Amen. The great portion of Christ's life when he was in the earth was dedicated to what? To ministering to the hurting people.
Yeah.
Healing the sick. Amen. The downtrodden people. The people that was cast out. The people that was isolated. The people that were how do you say that word? Oxidized. Oh wait, I don't know. Huh?
Ostracized.
Yeah, that word. Amen. Away from everybody. Amen. But see, that's what Jesus, he came to demonstrate the kingdom by walking in love with even the hurting people, the sick people, the possessed people. He demonstrated the kingdom by walking in love with all mankind, regardless of their status in life, regardless of what they was going through. Amen. Jesus ministered to the paralyzed and they got up and walked. He ministered to the blind and they was able to see. He ministered to the deaf and they was able to hear. He ministered to the crippled and they was able to get up and walk. Why? Because he was demonstrating the principles of the kingdom. He was showing us what was expected of us as a child of God. See, we are now our children of the kingdom. You say, "Well, Pastor, but I don't believe that still, I don't think that still apply today." Does the Bible, is the Bible still relevant today?
Yes.
Then what Christ did is still relevant today in our lives. You say, "Well, Pastor, I'm too old. I've had my part in life. I'm just waiting to go on to be with the Master." No, you're not too old. Well, you're a pastor. I'm too young. I'm just not turning. I'm just starting to understand. That's a good part. You are in the right age right now to begin your walk with God, where your life can make a difference in the people around you. Amen. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter how young you are. What matters is, are you willing to go? "Whom shall I send? And whom will go for us?" Then said I, this is Isaiah talking. "Then said I, here am I, send me." I said that before. Amen. And he took me up on my word. He's still sending me. He wants to send you to carry out the assignment he had placed upon your life. If you have any question of his healing power, you need to look at the scriptures. Just look up all the scriptures pertaining to his healing power. To walk in God's presence, you're going to walk in his intimacy. And to walk in his intimacy, you're going to walk in power. You're going to walk in power. Amen. So that's why he said, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night." See, if you allow this to have a place in your heart, you're going to begin to see, it's going to begin to establish faith in your heart. And that faith is going to release in you the supernatural presence of Almighty God. In that supernatural presence, there's going to be signs, wonders, and miracles that are going to, follow you. You don't have to run behind them. They're going to run behind you. And people are going to start seeing the presence of God upon your life. Then they're going to come to you. Amen. See, we are the generation that God is looking at to bring the kingdom of God back into the earth as it was in the early church.
Yes, amen. Wow.
We are that generation that God wants to wake up and bring us back into right alignment so that the kingdom of God, as it was in the early church, will manifest right now. If we don't allow this to come forth, then the generation that's around us right now, the people and the children around us right now, they are not going to experience the kingdom of God like we did when we was growing up. We are the examples. We are the light. We are God's chosen. He said, I have chosen you from the foundation of the world. Amen. Ain't that what he said? He's chosen us from the foundation of the world. When? Before we were formed in our mother's womb. He prepared us for this time. He's prepared us for this season that we are coming into. There's some danger coming along the line. It's going to be a whole lot worse than COVID-19. I'm telling you, and I've been telling you that since last year, God told me to tell you to prepare yourself by meditating upon the healing scripture. Because when it comes, the doctors ain't gonna want to see you, because they ain't gonna want what you got. You're gonna need Jesus to deliver you. You're going to need Jesus to heal you. Yes. To walk in God's presence, to walk in God's presence, yes. To walk in God's kingdom, yes. You can walk free of any sickness, any disease that the devil bring upon you.
Yes, yes, yes.
Woo! Glory to God. I know I'm telling you the truth.
You'll do it. Yes, he will.
Amen, amen, amen. So God has given us, he's given us everything that we need to maintain our walk. Because he wants to stay focused. He wants us to stay focused. Amen. Glory to God. It will have to be the gospel confirmed that's going to touch the world around us. If we're not going to draw close to God, that the kingdom of God will manifest in us and through us, the world around us is going to go deeper and deeper in darkness when you have been given the opportunity to bring them to the light. But you're going to have to play a vital part in them coming to the light. In other words, you got to make a firm commitment to God. You got to make a firm commitment to God. Amen. Because this message will help, that I'm sharing with you right now, this message will help point you in the right direction. Because to draw closer to God is to draw closer into his presence. To draw closer into his presence is going to establish an intimacy with God that you're going to have a dialogue between you and God like you never had before. And in that dialogue, God's going to begin to speak to your heart. There's going to be some times you're going to hear things that you don't want to hear. But there's also going to be some times you're going to hear things that you need to hear. That's going to set people free, even in your own household. Even in your own household. Oh, glory to God. I feel the kingdom of God manifesting in this place. I sense God's presence right now like I've never sensed it before. Why? Because God is talking. God is speaking. And he said, tell my people to prepare themselves. And the only way we can prepare ourselves is to understand our place in the kingdom. We can have fun. We can have singing. We can have parties in the church. But will that bring God's glory in the church? Or will it just make you feel good? We can have the flashing lights. But will that make God show up just because we put fog in the church? That don't cause God to show up. What caused God to show up is when we cry after him. When we long to be with him. When we desire him more than anything else in this world. Intimacy. Walking in his presence. Praying in the Spirit. Praying in the Spirit.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Look at Jeremiah chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1. Verse number. Oh God. Look at verse number 6. Then said I, Ah Lord God, behold, I cannot speak. See, a lot of us, we're concerned about how much we know, how much we don't know. When God have the ability to empower you by putting his word in your mouth and in your heart. Amen. Then said I, Ah Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. Listen to what he said. I am a child. Amen. What did God tell him when he said that? He said, what he said, verse number 7. But the Lord said unto me, say not that I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee to, thou shalt speak. Whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. This is why God is telling us, don't be afraid. Don't look at the faces. Don't allow what people are saying to cause you to fall back or to go backwards. Stay focused on what God has given you and begin and continue to press forward. Amen. Verse number 8 says, be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee. I am with thee to deliver thee, said the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put what?
My words
in thy mouth. God said, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, this is how we're going to be able to establish the kingdom of God in the earth as it was in the early church. See, if we don't meditate on the word, if we don't allow the word to have place in our heart, then we won't have the ability for the kingdom of God to manifest. Because see, God is looking at you and me to be able to reach out through. We are his instruments. We are his hands. We are the tools in God's hand to reach this darkness, to reach this dark world, to expose this darkness, to tear down the principalities and the powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world. He has given us the ability to walk in the presence of who he is without fear and without trembling.
Yes.
God has given us everything we need, the tools that we need to carry out the assignment. It's in his word. And if we take his word to heart and begin to meditate upon the word, that word going to begin to come alive in our spirit. And once that word begins to come alive in our spirit, it's going to bring forth revelation knowledge on how to apply what God has given you, that we can be the light that God created us to be, that we can bring this light into this dark world and expose this darkness and the principalities and the power that is working against this nation, against our cities, against our country. God will give us the power within his word that he placed in our mouth and in our heart, that as we speak it, God will confirm the word with signs following.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah. God will confirm the word with signs following. See, this is what God is saying. This is what God is saying. How can he confirm the word if we don't put it in our hearts? How can we walk in his presence? How can we walk in his principles if we don't put the word in our hearts? We can't. And he's not going to force us to do it. Amen. So he said in verse number 10 said, see, I have this day set thee over the nations of the and over the kingdoms of, and to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down and to build up and to build and to plant. You see, the Word of God has several avenues, several avenues that if we will allow His Word entrance in our heart, the Word of God has the ability to bring us to a place where our intimacy with God will take us way beyond the situation that we are facing.
Yes.
Mm.
Yes.
My God. Can you just see yourself right now experiencing, you know, you're sitting at home and you're starting to read your Bible a little bit, and you know, you may not read that much, but you just pick up and start reading, then all of a sudden the words start beginning to make sense to you. It began to open up your understanding, the understanding of your mind. And as it began to open up your understanding of your mind, it began to minister to your heart. And as it began to minister to your heart, it drops into your spirit. And all of a sudden, you say, wow, I read this all this time, but I never saw it this way. What happened? The Word of God began to come alive. That seed that you're planted in your heart began to germinate and began to bring forth the life and the nature of God in you. Now, all of a sudden, you're ready to minister to someone. You said, look, God, who do you want me to talk? Who can I talk to? Who is it, Lord God, that you want me to see? Amen. See, God wants to bring you to a place where you will not be afraid, not be ashamed, not even look backwards. He wants to bring you to a place where the Word of God will be the place. The Word of God will have the first, will have a place in your heart that He so longed to have. He so longed to have. Walking in God's presence. Adam and Eve had an intimate fellowship with God. They walked in His presence. Yeah, turn it down. You hot?
Yeah.
Turn it down. I'm hot too. Amen. Before the fall in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, they walked in the presence of God. The only one can walk in that presence that like they did then is the angels that's in the presence of God. Are you cold? Oh. But you just turn it on?
Yeah, for air conditioning.
Oh. Glory to God. Amen. So we see that God before the fall in the Garden of Eden, only the Adam and Eve had the opportunity to walk in the presence of God. Once they failed, they could not walk in God's presence like that no more. Because God sent them out of the garden. And He put a guard over the gate so they will not be able to come back in. Amen. Now, only one that can stand, can be in the intimate presence of God right now is the angels that's still in heaven. They're the only one can stand in God's presence right now. But get this. This is something you may not understand. This may be something that you may not realize. You today can stand in the presence of God through the intimacy of the Holy Ghost. The indwelling presence of God is in you. That is your doorway into God's presence, the Holy Spirit. That's why it's so important that we understand what God is telling us, because unless we understand this, we are not, and how are we going to understand if we don't study? How are we going to understand this if we don't read? How are we going to understand this if we don't allow it to have place in our heart? We have to read. We have to understand what God is saying to us, because that's the only way we're going to know that we can walk in His presence. Amen. It's through the Holy Ghost. Through the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost. Not through it, but in the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost. In His presence. Amen. Now let's look at something right here. In Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, verse number 8. I'm going to show you here. Genesis chapter 3, verse number 8, it says, "And they heard a voice of the Lord." They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife, they did what? They hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. They hid themselves. Why did they hide themselves? Because they knew they had made a wrong move in their lives. They made a mistake. And I wonder if they had said, God, please forgive me. I didn't mean to do it. I wonder if they would have asked God to forgive them at that point, what would have happened? We don't know that because they didn't ask him to forgive them. They probably didn't know they probably did not know that they could. But we know when we make a mistake today, we have an advocate with the Father. His name is Jesus. He's seated at the right hand of the Father right now, interceding for us, that we will get this message, that we will begin to hear what he's speaking to our hearts, that we begin to apply to our lives, so that the kingdom of God will manifest in the earth like it did in the early church. God wants to see signs, wonders, and miracles following you instead of you trying to follow them. God wants your life to become a proof of his indwelling presence. Amen. Instead of you trying to find somebody else to have God's presence in their life. He wants you to become that finished product instead of you trying to find somebody else that's become a finished product. Woo! Are y'all getting this? Because when you allow yourself to become a finished product, you're saying, God, I heard you say it. I understand it. Now, Father, I'm yielding to you right now. Have your way. I lay my life down. Father, I present my body to you as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is my reasonable service. Even though I not live good all my life, but God, I'm presenting my body to you right now. I lay my life down right now. I present my body to you as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, because that's what you ask of me, as a living sacrifice, that I will not be what? Conformed, Romans chapter 12, verse number 1 and 2, that I will not be conformed, verse number 2, to this world, but I be transformed by the renewing of my mind. If I don't meditate the Word of God, if I don't read the Word of God, if I don't spend time with the Word of God, my mind will not be renewed.
Jacked up.
That's right. It'll be jacked up. You're absolutely right. I ain't heard that word in a long time. It'll be jacked up. Amen. But if I spend that time with God, and the kingdom of God is going to begin to, the kingdom of God is going to begin to experience my presence, guess what? I'm going to begin to experience the presence of the kingdom of God.
Yes.
See, if I go into his presence, guess what? He's going to come into my presence. And when I come to his presence, he comes into my presence, this is what's going to happen, folks. Change.
Woo.
Deliverance.
Woo.
Healings.
Woo.
Woo. Provisions.
Yeah.
Mm. Everything that God promised will begin to manifest in your life. Now, you've been told some things by God early in your walk with God, and you still had not seen them come to pass yet. And you said, well, God, you said this, and I ain't never seen it come to pass yet. And God said, well, why have you not honored me? Why you keep turning away from me, and you expect me to honor you, and you won't, and you keep rejecting me? How many of you, God has spoke to your heart about some things you never seen to come to pass?
Well, I saw it come to pass.
You saw it come to pass?
Yeah, I was about 17 in a mission down on 2nd Street when it was all skid row. And I was playing a song on a trumpet, and this woman came up there who was conducting a service and said, I saw God open the door for an opportunity that most adults would like to have.
Yeah.
Well, he did. I didn't realize it, but he took me to her country.
Amen. Amen.
About 2 years later.
And look what you got.
He told me to be patient.
He told you to be patient? Amen. What? Anybody else? What did he tell you? See, God is, he's speaking to our hearts. And there's some things that we still have not seen come to pass yet. Then there are some of those that have seen some things from the bench, like you just said. Amen. And God wants to bring you to that place in your walk with him that when he begins to remind you of the things that he said to you, he's going to tell you, now is the time. Now is the time for you to experience my goodness. my mercies. Amen. Now is the time. Amen. That's why he tells us, amen, in Joshua, in Genesis chapter 3 again. Because you see, when he was driven out of God's presence, it just like, it put a dampen on his relationship with God. And then his children, when they start giving, when they start having birth, when they start giving, you know, start having children, the first born and the first two boys, one understood the principles of seed time and harvest. The other one was just trying to get by. One offered up the gift to God, and God looked upon his gift as pleasing. The other one offered up the gift to God, and God looked upon his not worthy. And what happened to the one that was not worthy? He killed the one that was pleasing. Y'all know who I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Abel and Cain. Abel,
yeah.
See, when people are trying to do right, the one is always trying to focus on just trying to get by. They're going to do everything they can to try to manipulate the ones that is trying to do right. They might even try to take your life, like Cain did to Abel. Not like Abel did to Cain, whichever way that was. Amen. I want you to know that God is not going to hurt you. God wants to empower you. God wants to strengthen you. He wants you to be the light of the world. He wants you to shine so bright. He wants you to be the one that's, that when people look at you, they're going to say, there's something strange about that person. Woo! And all of a sudden, you're going to find yourself, in the presence of the Lord, and the people that God's going to bring in your path, they're going to be drawn to you, and it's going to be for a purpose. Why? Because the kingdom of God is working in you. The kingdom of God is coming alive on the inside of you. And when you are walking in the presence of the kingdom of God, God said, the works that I do shall you do also, and greater works these shall you do, because I go to my Father. Well, what did they do? In Luke chapter 9, verse number 1, and Jesus called his 12 disciples together, and he gave them power and authority. See, you got authority and power. Amen. Well, your enemy only have power. But God has given you authority over his power. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 21, and he said, amen. So you've been seated in heavenly places, far above. Verse number 20, far above principalities and powers and mighty dominion. So you are in a place in God because you're part of the kingdom. But if you don't understand what God has placed in you, you are not going to be able to exercise the principles of the kingdom. Remember what he said in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 6? We are seated in Christ Jesus in heavenly places. In heavenly places. Chapter 1, verse number 21 says, far above all principalities and powers. So if we've been seen in heavenly places, then we've been established in the kingdom, then God is going to continue to bring us to a place where we will see ourselves not being defeated as children of God. God don't want you to be defeated. God wants you to be victorious. You're an overcomer. You overcome Satan by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of your testimony. God said, for this purpose the Son of God was manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. You have the ability of God in you to destroy the works of the devil. He tells us in Luke chapter 16, verse number 17. Are y'all here? These signs shall follow them that believe in my name, shall they cast out devils. It's the kingdom of God in you that's going to be doing this. It's not you. It's God's presence in you. Your voice is being used, but it's not you doing it. God said, the works that I do shall you do also. It's God working in you to carry out the assignment. John chapter 14, verse number 10. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. God is doing the work. You just a vessel in God's hand. The kingdom of God manifests in you and through you to reach the hurting people of the world. God is looking for someone that he can use in these last days. Will you be that one? Will you say, God, here am I, send me, I'll go? Or will you stand back and say, ooh. I never seen it this way. Ooh. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. But God is showing us, if we're going to walk in the principles of the kingdom, we're going to walk in intimacy with God. And walking in intimacy with God, we're going to experience his presence like never before. Yes. We're going to experience his presence like never before. And then this generation can be like the early church, the generation of the early church. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Because when the kingdom of God begin to manifest, the presence of God is going to be so evident that the world is going to start coming back to God by the thousands and by the millions. But it's going to take the church of God knowing who they are and begin to pray, begin to worship God, begin to pray in the spirit and pray with the understanding also. As we begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, begin to pray in the Spirit and with our understanding, we're saying, God, I don't understand it all. I don't need to understand it. I just know that I'm doing what you call me to do. And because I believe that, because I understand that, God, here I am. Here I am. Amen. Then all of a sudden, the presence of God is going to start manifesting in your life and upon your life. And someone is going to come to you and say, you know, my child just had a bad accident, and I don't know what to do. I need help. And you all of a sudden, can I pray for you and your child? And this person gonna say, yeah, I can use some prayer right now. Then all of a sudden, you grab this person by the hand. You start praying for this person. The power not just going to hit her or him, but this power is going to flow because his spirit, right? It's going to flow onto that child or that person that they are praying for. Why? Because they are standing in the gap. They are their point of contact. They are the point of contact. And you're releasing God's power. You're releasing God's ability. You're releasing God's miracle power through prayer for that person, and it's tricking it on back to that person. I'm telling you what I know is going to happen if you do it. If you allow God to have first place in your heart, you'll be used by God like you never thought you would before. And people are going to be asking you to come. Will you come and pray? Will you come and pray? Will you come and pray? Then all of a sudden, you're going to find yourself being busy for God. Yeah. Then all of a sudden, people are going to start hearing about you. They're going to see the kingdom of God manifest in your life and through your life on the behalf of the hurting people. That's what Jesus ministered to when he was in the earth. He ministered to the hurting. He ministered to the downtrodden. He ministered to the down and out. He ministered to the leprosy. He ministered to the cripple. He ministered to the demon possessed. He ministered to the dead. This is what God manifesting in the earth in these last days. The kingdom of God is going to come forth in power in these last days. You want to see what I'm telling you? It's going to come like it was in the early church. The church of God is going to begin to walk in supernatural miracles, signs, and wonders like the early church did. Those that are really serious with God. Those that are serious with God. They're going to experience the intimacy of God. And the intimacy of God is going to release God's ability in the earth again, just like it did in the early church. Just like it did in the early church. Right now, I exercise authority over every germ. I exercise authority right now over every flu, every germ, every virus that would try to attack your body. I exercise that authority right now in the spiritual realm, and I come against it, I break it, I renounce it, I loose it from its assignment off of your life right now in the name of Jesus. I declare, decree today that you are walking in divine health and healing. Healing is the chosen bread. Receive it now in Jesus' name. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. And I know that the enemy is attacking, because God told me that this thing that is coming is going to come suddenly. It's going to start working, creeping in different areas. Amen. And I know what I'm talking about. And I declare and decree that it will not touch you. You stay faithful to God. You stay connected to His service, to His man of God. You will find out that connection is going to save your life. I'm just speaking. I'm just speaking what God put in my heart. Amen. But you are God's children. You're the one that He's talking to. Amen. To walk in the power of the kingdom of heaven, we must watch our relationship with others. What kind of relationship that you are involved around? What people are you allowing in your life? Amen. You got to watch your relationship, because there's a lot of people going to try to come into your life, especially when God's starting to deal with you and God's starting to move into your realm. Amen. There's some people going to try to come into your life to distract you from your calling, to distract you from your purpose. You got to watch your relationship with others. That's one of the main keys. You got to watch your relationship. Amen. Now, I don't know about you, but, you know, sometimes it could be family members. I know what I'm talking about, because I've been through it already. It could be family. So you got to watch your relationship with others, amen, and how we conduct ourselves around them and with them. We got to watch our communication with them, because they're not going to understand what you're talking about, and they're going to use every word you say and try to use it against you, try to make you look like a fool. But you know who you are as a child of God, amen. And then you got to. Then you got to understand that as you watch your relationship, and if you get out of line, you got to be quick to repent. Be quick to repent. Amen. Be quick to repent. And you got to come back in the realm of faith. You got to quickly repent, and you got to acknowledge, God, I made a mistake. He's not going to hold it against you as long as you acknowledge it. Because you see, once you make them, if you make that mistake, you're going to be just like Adam and Eve. You're going to be out of God's presence. You won't be, God is not going to look on you when there's sin in your heart and in your life. Why? Remember what He said in Isaiah chapter 59, verse number 2? He said, your sins have separated between me and your God, between you and God. So God, our sin will cause us not to be able to come into God's presence. That's why we have to, you know, there's some things we might be doing in our life right now that God has been dealing with our heart about, and we're praying, we're not seeing our prayers been answered. It could be because you're not repented yet, and God is trying to get you in the right place where your heart can be, where you can come back into that presence of Him, into His presence. Amen. So we need to make sure our heart is clean. Make sure our heart is clean. How's our heart going to be clean? When we acknowledge, God, I made a mistake, and, you know, I sinned. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And God is not looking for lip service. God is looking for a heart that is turned around and stop going in the direction of sin, but turn around and start coming into the direction where He is. Because if you're still going in the direction of that sin, you're not repentant. You're just trying to make yourself feel good. Yeah. Lord, I repented. Yeah, I know, but you're still going the same thing. Remember, when Jesus died on the cross, he died once and for all. He's not going to go back and die again. He don't have to. He paid the price for your sin. That's why all you got to do is just ask him sincerely from your heart. Sincerely from your heart. God, forgive me. Forgive me. And then, once you know that God have heard you, then just turn around. And don't go back that way no more. Because when you go back to it, something worse is going to come upon you than what you experienced. And it's not going to be so easy to get away from it.
That's right.
Because the devil knows that if he can keep you in that same rut, he can, that stronghold that he's trying to establish will become more stable, more secure. Amen. That's why he tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God through the pulling down the stronghold. Amen. See, the devil wants to establish a stronghold in your heart. That's why if he can keep you focused on your error and keep you going in the direction, that he can cause you to miss out on the greatest thing that God could ever bring forth in your life. And that is total deliverance, total healing, total peace. Peace that surpasses of all understanding will begin to keep your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus, because you chose to do right. You see the sin, you see what you're doing, but God, you said, Lord, I see this and I know that it's looked good and keep coming after me, but God, even though it looked good and it's still coming after me, God, I choose you. I choose you over that. I choose more of you over that sin. I choose more of you over that adultery. I choose more of you over that fornication. I choose more than you over that drug. I choose more than you over that lying. I choose more than you over that pornography. I choose more than you over whatever the sin it is. You got to learn to choose God over that sin. Because what the devil is trying to do is trying to manipulate you to make you think that it's okay. You see, it's okay. How long you been doing this? Ain't nothing happened to you yet. It's nothing going to happen to you. It's okay. That's the spirit of deception. See, it may not look like it's happening right then and there. Everything's still looking real good. But later on, that what you have done is going to start weighing on your heart. And you're going to wish you had stopped. Because now, what you've done, you set in motion the thing that God's spoken out of his own mouth concerning us in this area. What did he say? The wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. As by one man sin entered into this world, so death by sin, so death passed upon all, because all have sinned. That's God's penalty for sin. But he gave us an advocate. He gave us a way out. He said, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to what? To forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, if you want that intimacy with God, then you have to start asking God, God, I need help in this area. I keep going back to it, and I know it's not pleased to you, God, and I tried to quit on my own, but I can't. I need you. God, help me. Help me. God is not going to get mad at you because you, when he see you doing that, especially if you're asking him to help you,
yes,
all of a sudden, that what you've been struggling with is not going to be an issue. Because he's going to start giving you the strength to overcome
right.
it because you've asked him
that's
to help you.
Right.
It's only going to continue to be a stronghold in your life if you continue to go at it without realizing that what you're doing is destroying you. If you're going to walk in the kingdom of God, You got to put away lying. You got to walk in love. You can't tell me that you love me and then you're going to lie to me in my face. That's not love. Amen. I'm going to stop right now because I've got a whole lot more along this line that we're going to be sharing. Amen. We always have. Now, next Sunday, I won't be here. I won't be here next Sunday.
Where are you going?
San Diego. I'm not going to Texas yet. I'll let you know. But I'm going to San Diego. I'm going to conference. See, I've been pouring out. Now I need to go get strength in myself. Amen. Me and my family. Amen. And it's going to be powerful. It's going to be powerful. When I come back, I'm going to come back powered. I'm going to come back on fire. Amen. I love you guys. And I'm going to always always bring you the word of the Lord from the bottom of my heart, the best way that I can. And that was truth. Amen. And that was truth. See, I have all these notes right here. I didn't get a chance to go through not even one page today because the Lord kept carrying me through different areas because he wants to impart things to you by the Spirit of God. Amen. We believe that God is about to show up and show himself strong. The kingdom of God is about to come forth in the church of God like never before. In these last days, the church is going to begin to experience the miracles, signs, and wonders as the early church did, because God is bringing us back into this realm, because the generation, and that's like, there's three generations right now are in danger of missing out on the presence of God. Three generations. The Holy Spirit just put that in my spirit. He just spoke that to my heart. Just now. This is why this is so important, that this message continue to be preached. Because I was sitting down here praying just Friday night. And I was trying to think, Lord, which way you want me to go? Which way you want me to continue this year? And what did the Lord say? Stay the course. Stay the course. And I said, okay, I'll stay the course. That what you want me to do? I can do that.
2024.
Amen. Huh?
2024.
That's right. Stay the course. Stay the course. And I said, okay, I can do that. Glory to God. Now, when God said that, it kind of took me by surprise. I'm trying to see, because I thought I... Okay. Stay the course is a phrase used in the context of a war or battle, meaning to pursue a goal regardless of any obstacle or circumstance or whatever.
Situation.
Yeah, situation, circumstance. Amen. So we see that this model usage of this term was popularized by United States President George H.
Bush.
Yeah, George H.W. Bush. Amen. Stay the course. Amen. See, this was the military term that God told us. Remember Friday night we was here praying? When God said stay the course? This is a military term. That's how come I know that we are in spiritual warfare right now, like we've never been before. And God is telling us to stay the course. So let's stay the course. Amen. Let's hold fast to what God has given us. It's time for us to prepare our tithes and offerings right now. I got to stop. It's time for us to prepare our tithes and offerings right now. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you and I praise you and I glorify you, Father, that your word is working in us the hope of glory. Set your heart on us, Lord, as we set our hearts on you, to honor you, to please you, to be a blessing to you, to your house, to your word, to the ministry of the gospel. And Father, as we do, we ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, that we will experience the outpouring of your presence in our lives. We thank you for it now, Father, in Jesus' name. Those of you who want to sow a seed, you can go to my website, librarybrookenministries.com. You can use your, you can go to my your postal service, that's P.O. Box 417-7973, Sacramento, California, 95841. That's P.O. Box 417-9913, Sacramento, California, 95841. Amen. Or you can use your cash app. That's Larry Bergens. Look me up. You'll see me with my military baseball cap on. Or you can use PayPal. Just type my name, Pastor Larry Bergens, in PayPal. And also you can use Zelle. And then you, to use Zelle, you just type my email, LarryBergens@gmail.com. It'll go straight into my account, into the ministry account. That's LarryBergens@gmail.com. First name, last name, @gmail.com. Amen. And it'll go straight into the account from Zelle. Amen. Or you can also use Venmo. You can give that way. Amen. Whichever way you give, make sure you're giving it to the Lord and not to man. Because it's God that's going to bring you to that place of security and finances. It's God that's going to meet your every need, not me. It's God. Amen. What you're doing, helping us keep these doors open, your tithes, your offerings, it helps us to keep these doors open so that we can continue to do what God called us to do. I thank God for all you that support us by the internet. We thank God for you. Amen. We ask you that if you can sow a seed right now, it'll be well received. And also, we're preparing, like I said, we're still looking at going back to Pakistan again. I'm still trying to get the exact date the Lord wants me to go. I wanted to go April, but I'm still here. I still hadn't received the clearance from the Lord yet. Amen. I'm waiting on to hear the clearance, because you see, I could go, but will I be able to accomplish what I need to accomplish while I'm there? When he tell me now is the time, then I know that I can go and I will accomplish that what he put on my heart to accomplish. And so, those of you that are with us by the internet, those of you that are helping us, working with us, supporting us, if God put it upon your heart to sow a significant seed other than your tithes, your offering, amen, name it mission. Name that seed mission. And then whatever need that you have in your life that you want God to minister to you in that area, then also put that name that you want God to minister in your area on that seed also. You name that seed and you label that seed as the area that you want God to minister back to you in. Amen. And I believe I'm going to release my faith with you. I'm going to join with you in faith. My prayer warriors and I, we're going to join with you in faith. We're going to believe that God is moving by the power of His Spirit, that every need is met according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Father, I thank you for this time together. I thank you, Father, that as we have heard your word, it has come to that time, Father, where we give our tithes, our offering. Because you said, Father, ever since the world been, there's always been seed time and harvest. And God, we can't expect a harvest where we have not planted seed. And if we sow a little seed, then we can't expect no big harvest. But if we plant a good seed, a big seed, then we can expect a big harvest. God, I believe that your people, under the sound of my voice, will plant that seed in the area of their need, and then they will begin to receive according to that seed that they have planted. So, Father, I bless your people, and I give you all the praise and all the glory for what you're doing in their lives and in their relationships, in their families, and in their finances, in Jesus' name, because I know, God, that all things work together for good to them that love you, to those who are called according to your purpose, in Jesus' name. Receive the offering. Amen. God bless you. Now, if you're here today, you never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life, I'm going to give you that opportunity right now. You never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life. Maybe you have made Jesus Christ Lord of your life, but you backslid. You were not able to continue your walk. You turned away from God. Amen. You backslid. Now God is giving you an opportunity to come back to Him. Amen. But maybe you have never asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart to be your Lord and Savior. But right now, God is saying to He's saying to you right now, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone will open up to me and let me in, I will come in and I will sup with him and he with me. God is not wanting you to go to hell. That hell was not created for you. It was not created for man. It was created for the devil and his angels. But you notice that many people are yielding to Satan and his demons. And they've been brought into hell right along with them. Why? Because they don't want to be there by themselves. They're looking for people that will follow their lead and do wicked things to bring them to be with them, to keep them company. I don't want to keep the devil and his demons company. What about you? Then don't. You don't have to. Ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins. Say this prayer with me right now. Say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart. Create in me a right spirit and renew in me a clean heart. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God and that you died for my sin. Today, I confess my sin. Forgive me, Lord. I receive you now as my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. Whew. I felt the Holy Ghost on that today. Amen. Those of you that said that prayer with me, listen to me. You might have committed sins that you might thought that God would never forgive you of. I want to tell you right now that your sins are forgiven. And God loved you. He gave His Son for you. And because you ask Him, He has forgiven you. And He's given you a brand new start. He's given you a new beginning. Take advantage of what God has just did for you. And begin to study the Word of God. Begin to read the Word of God. Begin to meditate upon the Word of God. As He said in Joshua chapter 1, verse number 8. You want to be a success in your walk with God? Then you're going to have to spend time with God in reading the Word and meditating the Word. Amen. And you're going to find out that God's Word will begin to strengthen you in every area of your life. And you thought that you were going to fall and not be able to get up. Let me tell you something. God has just raised you back up. He's just raised you back up. He put your feet back on the path of righteousness. God loves you just that much that He forgives you. Oh, no matter what you have done, He has just forgiven you. Amen. Oh, thank you, Father. Now, Father, I just pray for everyone that said that prayer. And I ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, to show yourself strong on their behalf. And may they come to understand, Father, that your love for them is a whole lot greater than what the devil tried to bring them into. Let your love cover them and let the blood of Christ deliver them. I thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Well, God bless you all. Amen. Those of you that need prayer right now, I pray for you right now. If you need prayer, I pray for you right now. If your body's under attack by the enemy, amen, then let me pray for you. Let me.
My body's still itching. I don't know why. So I keep praying and praying every day.
Every day? And it still hits you? Day and night. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you so much for this young lady. I thank you, Father, that your hand continually rests upon her. And Father, today, I release the anointing right now in every organ of her body. I release the anointing right now in every organ of her body. I rebuke every distraction that will try to attack her organs. I rebuke it in the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. I release divine health. I release divine health and healing from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. In the name that is above every name, be healed in Jesus' name.
Don't come.
Thank you. There it is. Receive it.
Jesus,
there
name.
It is. Shh. Thank you for it, Father.
Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. My young friends. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these two young ladies. And I thank you, Father, that your hand is still upon them to bring them to a place, Father, in their life early, God, that they will know you, that they will walk with you, that they will understand you dealing with their hearts at an early age. God, that you would touch them, Father, that you would bring them to the spirit of obedience, Father, and that the Spirit of God would begin to rest upon them, directing their every step, their every thought, Lord God, everything, Father, that the enemy has brought to their hearts, to their minds, trying to lure them and to walk, turn them away from you, Lord God, I rebuke it, I loose it from its assignment now. I apply the blood of Jesus from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. Now, Father, breathe upon them. And then, Father, show yourself strong on their behalf. I bless them now in Jesus' name. Father, I bless this young man, their father. I ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, to let him be a light to them. Let him, Father, be the strength to help them to see their way through the dark places that life trying to push them in. God, I thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
You're walking in divine health. You're healed. You're free in Jesus' name. Amen. Anyone else? Come on, sir. Okay. Father, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke every attack against his body, against his organs. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke, and I loose from his assignment right now, in the name of Jesus, every tumor, every cursed word that's been spoken over his health, I release it from his assignment now. I apply the blood of Jesus over every organ of his. I shout out about Kai, out about Messiah, in the name of Jesus. I apply the blood of Jesus over every organ right now in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Receive it now. There it is. Receive it. Oh, shout out about Kai. In the name of Jesus. Woo. Don't fall, man. Anybody else? Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those that are with us by the internet. I release that anointing, Father. Oh, God, I thank you. Woo. Glory to God. I declare and decree, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' name. Receive it as God speaking to you. God bless you. We love you. Join us tonight at 6:30 as we come to you with a powerful message straight from the throne of grace. Amen. We love you. Until then, be blessed. God bless you. Bye-bye.